Hello, good evening, and welcome to Love Talk. Now, isn't it just a pain when the person you're with has this hobby that takes over his life, takes over your relationship, and you really don't know what to do with it? How do you react to that?
Well, you have to be patient, isn't it? I mean, if it's your partner, especially we're talking about love life here, mm-hmm. you just have to, you know, go along.
Yeah. And sometimes you're blessed enough to find one person who has the exact same passion and hobby that you have. In fact, we have someone in the studio today, Erika Poole, who'll be talking exactly about this. And we're going to be giving you a few tips that if your partner has a hobby that maybe is not really your hobby, you can make things work for both of you. And hey, it's always a healthy thing to have a mm-hmm. passion, to be passionate about something. Don't turn it into something negative. We're going to see what the people of London have to say about this, and we'll be right back here in the studio.
Do you think it's important to understand your partner's interests, like such as hobbies, things that he likes to do, or do you think it's okay just to be, oh no, he has to do what I like because if he loves me, blah 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 blah. What do you think?
No, I think you need to have hobbies that you do together as a team. I think there needs to be a couple things that you do differently so you don't crowd each other's space too much, but I feel like you should have both equal balance between your own likes and the likes that you share together.
Okay, so there will be compromise sometimes, right? Sometimes you don't like to do something like football, but you still...
Then sometimes you'll still do it, but other times you'll sit out.
Right now we have a thing going on because I want to run triathlons and she doesn't. So it's like an ongoing debate right now in our relationship is when she comes to Victoria to live with me, we're going to run triathlons. So
okay, she doesn't think we will.
I think there's definitely a degree of importance with your, you know, I guess a syncing of your hobbies and interests, but I don't think it's that important because a lot of women that I've been in relationships with, they're actually quite different from me. Okay. So I think maybe sometimes, I think in certain cases opposites attract, but in other cases some people just like to be in a safe and comfort zone, so they know, they go with someone they know about, and you know, hobbies that they, you know, share and such things. But you know, for me, I don't really mind, but I, for me personally, I like an opposite. I don't want someone that's similar to me.
As long as she pull up with my football, I don't mind.
So you are a football fan?
Yes, Chelsea all over. I don't like Arsenal at all. As long as she pull up with my football, I can pull up with anything else, I don't mind.
Yeah, even long hours of shopping?
No.
Are you sure? 100%
sure. No, I don't do shopping.
So no compromising, like you do a bit for me, I do a bit for you?
Yes, but I don't do shopping. I don't do shopping at all. No, it's too much.
Most definitely. It's always important to sort of take into consideration like the things that your partner do, because at the end of the day, it's like two worlds coming together as one, isn't it? So you have to sort of mould the two. Even certain things that you don't like, you just sort of got to learn to accept at the end of the day, isn't it? Because it makes that person happy, and all you want is to make that person happy too, isn't it?
So you don't think that it's all about your shopping and what you like to do? And
It's give and take, isn't it, basically? At the end of the day, it's, yeah, like I said, two coming together as one. And if you can't work together, or you know, show interest in other people's hobbies and loves and passions, then it just won't work.
The same way I would like her to actually trying to find out what I like.
If she doesn't do that, what do you think could happen?
Then it becomes something where she becomes an object and I become an object to her too.
Now, hobbies, right? Hobbies can be very healthy for a person, but sometimes in a relationship, there are couples who have a little bit of a friction with hobbies, mm-hmm. right? Because it becomes an obsession.
And it brings some of the problems, like financial problems.
Depending,
you know,
on what it is.
Disagreements, yeah,
If he does racing and he has to pay for repairs of the car and everything by himself, then it becomes a little bit of a strain, right? And today we're going to talk about this. We're going to talk about how you can turn something which perhaps has been causing a little bit of a friction into something that it's healthy in the relationship. And perhaps, you know, when people get together, they bring with them hobbies they had before, but you can always create new hobbies, something you're both passionate about, right?
Of course, and hobbies are really so healthy. Mm-hmm. I mean, life is so difficult as it is, you know, so many challenges, so many obligations, you know, you have to work long hours, you have mm-hmm. to do this and that. Having a hobby just...
So after 12 years that we've been married, what are we both passionate about that we do together?
Arsenal.
That's actually not true, right? But she tries to take an interest in the football, although she's not very passionate about it. But
I'm beginning to like it. Yeah, especially after our trip there. You
so
know?
How does the offside rule work?
I don't know.
So she's not there yet, but she'll get there in the end. Now today we have here in the studio with us Erika, Erika, good evening.
Hi, thanks for coming.
Can you tell us a little bit, because you're married.
I am.
And you have a very interesting hobby which your husband shares. Can you tell us a little bit about how you guys met and how that hobby is something that you guys share together?
Yeah, our hobby is actually aerial trapeze and aerial circus in general. And actually we met in an online dating site. And what interested me was his profile actually said that he did rock climbing and skating, but he wanted to try trapeze, but there was a waiting list. And I thought, well, you know, it's always great to get more guys into the pool because there's quite a lot of women that do it. And I knew a place where he could train that there wasn't a waiting list. So, and he thought it was quite cute as well. So yeah, I contacted him and then we met and clicked right away. And about 3 weeks later, I said, okay, so are you gonna try trapeze now? And he went, oh, I have to really do it, okay. And yeah, and he started it and loved it and still doing it 4 years later. So
it's something that both of you enjoy doing together.
Yes.
But tell me something. How did you get into the whole trapeze thing and how did you start liking that activity? How did it all happen?
It actually comes from kind of another ex-boyfriend. We were looking, this was a few years ago, we were looking for interesting things to do in London. And I saw this advertisement for a half-day circus taster. Mm-hmm. And I thought, well, you know, something unusual. So we
unusual.
Yeah, yeah. Signed us up and it was static trapeze, flying trapeze, juggling and acrobalance. And we went and I saw the static trapezes and just got hooked. He never got into it, but really? I did. Okay. And yeah, it's been about 7-8 years now.
There's also something else that you do, which is, I wouldn't say it's a hobby, but it's more of a lifestyle, because you're quite passionate about traveling, right?
Yes.
And that's something that your husband likes to do as well. Tell us a little bit about how much time that takes of your life.
Well, before we met, he'd done like 3 week trips here and there, and I'd done 6 months, like a big trip, maybe 10 years ago. But after we got married, we started talking about what we wanted to do. We decided to actually take off quite a large chunk of time and go around the world. And I've just come back from 14 months.
Wow. 14 months.
Yes.
And you were telling us you visited how many countries in those 14 months?
36.
36 countries.
5 continents, 36 countries, yeah.
Were you tired after that?
I was all right.
I have to ask this question.
I was all right, because I think one of the smartest things we did was in the middle, we actually did some volunteer work. So we stayed in one place for 6 weeks, and that was perfect, you know, to get into a bit of a routine, get recharged, and then go again.
And usually with the thing of the routine, I usually find from talking to couples that men seem to prefer routine more than women. Do you find that's true? Who likes a routine most, you or your husband?
He's definitely the math guy and I'm the words girl. So he definitely is much more into kind of strict. We had a spreadsheet for our whole trip.
Really?
Wow. It was very accurate.
Who did the spreadsheet?
Oh, him.
He did.
Oh, him.
So I'm saying it's
so definitely, into routine.
Now, the good thing about your, not just your hobby, but this lifestyle you have of traveling a lot, is that you found a common ground that both of you liked, right? Do you feel that helps a relationship? Because with the 14 month trip, you said you spent a lot of time together.
Oh, every minute of every day.
How was it?
Yeah.
What was it like?
Oh, it's good. I mean, it was fantastic. I mean, it's really bonding, but there are times where, you know,
electricity.
Exactly, and you don't want to hear them talk anymore.
Yeah.
But with the hobby especially, like, it's really good because we have something we can talk about. If I try to explain something I've done or some accomplishment I've achieved, like some skill I've learned, he understands rather than me trying to have to tell him and him not really getting it.
And feeling that he's not really interested, like.
Yeah. And there's a little bit of a level of competition as well, because I started doing circus before he did. Mm-hmm. So then, you know, the things he can do that I can't do, he gets a bit like,
oh, really?
Yeah.
Now there's, you know, this show is about hobbies that can create tension and problems. So maybe you say, well, why are you showing us someone in the show that has everything worked out in terms of hobbies? There is one hobby that your husband took on that you're not really that passionate about or fond of, but you're going to tell us about that in the second half, right, of this show. But something I wanted to talk about, Helena, with couples now, is that when a relationship starts, you know, you before that you were two individuals. You did everything on your own, right? Yeah. So of course you're going to bring into the relationship stuff that you enjoy doing on your own. Mm-hmm. And perhaps you're going to keep on doing, right? But when you start a relationship, then you have to find something, a common ground that both of mm-hmm. you can do together, because that's going to, you know, bring like a unity, yeah. and like Erika said, a healthy competition.
Or maybe the person still doesn't like mm-hmm. her partner's hobby, but you know, she understands his hobby, she understands what the hobby does to him,
yeah.
the benefits of that hobby, and she will just enjoy it together. She might not even like it that much.
Yeah. And sometimes it's not just a hobby per se, because for example, someone said in the street interviews about shopping, that he doesn't do shopping. And the good thing about us is that we don't really like shopping centers and that kind of stuff. But
yeah,
although we
yeah.
don't have a hobby together, we like to do the same thing, to go to the countryside and relax. Yeah. And that is something that you can, it's a common ground between both, right? Mm-hmm.
It's very important. But you mm-hmm. know what? You didn't actually tell the public your hobby.
I don't know if I should.
Do you know why? Because we were talking before we mm-hmm. started recording the show about when the hobby becomes like, you know, when the person gets really interested into something.
And into it.
Yeah, and then she says, oh, I'm going to buy this and that, and then maybe get this gadget, and then, wow, mm. No, this is it.
So what is the hobby?
It has happened to you, isn't it?
Yeah, I hope we're talking about the same thing here, because if we're not, we're in trouble. But
your little gym things and your little
yeah, it's just that I like running a lot. I like to de-stress while I run. So it's something that I've tried to get Helena to do together with me. Hasn't really worked.
Not yet. No.
But no problem. It's not a stress thing for both of us. But it's something that she, although she doesn't do it, she enjoys when I do it because it makes me feel better and happier. And this is the thing we're going to talk about in the second half, because even if it's something that you don't do together, you know, if it's something that helps your partner, makes him happy or makes her happy, then you should back him up, do you think?
Yes, absolutely. I agree with that. You know, it's healthy for your relationship. You mm-hmm. have different things to talk about when you get home, or, you know.
And if he's happy, you're happy.
Of course. And if your woman is happy, trust me, everyone will be happy. The house, the cousins, the aunties,
yeah.
the grandmother, everyone will be happy.
And we're talking about the hobby for both, because men and women both should have something
yes.
that they enjoy doing to relieve the stress and so on, right? Another one of my passions, which Helena seems to have, she is trying to get into, is Arsenal Football Club. In the second half, you'll see we had the privilege to do like a tour of the stadium, and we're going to show you some image, some footage of that, okay? When we come back in the second half, you're going to hear from Erika. What is the one thing that her husband took on recently that she, although she's supportive, is not her biggest passion in the world? Don't go anywhere. We'll be right back. Welcome back. Now, we have a video prepared for you of Erika and her husband doing the trapeze. How would you introduce that?
It's doubles trapeze. I do have to say, this is just practice. This is just us kind of messing around and learning yeah. some new tricks in practice. So,
yeah, and you know, is it something that people can try actually?
Oh yeah. I mean, in London itself, there's about 5 different places that you can do circus. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But it's all over the UK. It's actually pretty much all over the world. We found it. There's circus schools and circus areas to train mm-hmm. pretty much in most countries, most major cities.
Okay. So let's see what they were up to when they were training, and we hope you enjoy it, and maybe it's something you want to try. We'll be right back. Right, I was just trying to persuade Helena here to go and try that, but I don't think it's going to work.
I don't think it's going to happen, no.
Do you have to be very fit to do something like that, or you were saying you get fit?
You get fit. I mean, when I started, I had no upper body strength at all. Mm-hmm. But that's doubles trapeze, where you do it together. You can mm-hmm. also do it on your own. Mm-hmm. But you get really strong really fast. Mm-hmm. It's great for fitness. Right. Fantastic.
Wow, what if you don't have lower...
upper body strength?
Upper and lower...
Oh, no. The first what thing, happens? First thing they do is make you do conditioning. So you sit on the trapeze and you do pull-ups. Mm. Oh. But seriously, you can do tricks from right away, mm-hmm. and then you just get stronger and stronger every week. It's really good. It's fantastic for strength.
Right. Okay. Now, we want to know about that hobby that your husband really is getting into or got into, that it's not one of your favorite things.
Yes. Well, my husband has a tendency to kind of go all or nothing. So when he finds mm-hmm. something he likes, he'll go and do it quite hard, quite full on. And his new thing is he's decided that he's going to brew his own beer.
Right.
Okay.
Yes, exactly. A friend of his mentioned it and he thought, oh, I like that idea. And within a few days, we had the entire kit. And he's talking about, you know, bottle caps and malt and barley and hops and, yeah.
So that's not, for example, with your traveling, you guys can talk about that for hours, I imagine. But with this is something that do you try to be interested just to make him happy, or?
Yeah, I mean, I'm not a beer drinker. Mm-hmm. And I mean, I've tried a lot of beers around the world, mm-hmm. pretty much don't like very many. Mm-hmm. But, you know, as long as he keeps talking about it to a minimum, then mm-hmm. I can get excited, nod, smile, yes. I will try his beer. I keep mm-hmm. trying it at each stage. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I don't think it's ever going to be something that I'm too keen on.
Is he happy when you try to take an interest in that?
Yes, of course. You mean, you have to be supportive. Yeah. And, you know, like I said, I'll try it. Mm-hmm. I'm no expert on beer, so I tell him what I think. But mm. yeah.
What about the house? I'm sure he requires a lot of space for his experiments and all this.
Yeah, he's kind of been relegated to the garage, mm-hmm. but we don't have a car at the minute, so the garage is his own man cave.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yes, it's his brewing center.
Right. So you know, this is something very important that Erika just said, that, you know, even if it's not your thing, it's not something you're passionate about, but it's important that you're supportive, because I imagine there's other things that you sometimes want to do or want to pursue that mm-hmm. he tries to support you, right?
Yeah, I mean, he's not interested in everything I do. Mm-hmm. And I mean, I'm definitely probably more interested in circus than mm-hmm. he is. But I figure he likes it, he does it, so I can't complain if he doesn't want to do it mm-hmm. you know, as in-depth as me or mm-hmm. go to all the events that I want to go to.
Yeah.
It's actually interesting when you have someone who likes something, because... You know, I remember my husband asking me, you know, in an instance we were talking about, you know, his hobby and running, and I was like, oh yeah, I think I'm going to try, you know, I'm still in search for the hobby, you know, something that really helps me relax. I haven't found that thing yet, but I will not lose hope. And then he bought me the gear, the trainers, and he was like, yeah, let's go online and find you the proper shoe and everything. I love my pink trainers.
Oh, but yeah. That didn't really kick off. It never got going.
I wear them for other things. But, you know.
But yeah. You see, the interesting thing here is that, you know, because you have two people in a relationship who are different, and they may have a common ground on many other things, on values and principles, but you'll never be 100% in tune with everything that you do. And you think differently, you have different hobbies, different passions. And the secret to making that relationship work is not to stop that that hobby, right? Mm-hmm. It's to try to encourage the hobby, to take an interest. But of course, there are people that sometimes do take it to, or the partner feels they take it to an extreme, right?
Yes.
I heard about, surprisingly, a Tottenham fan, who are Arsenal's biggest rival, surprisingly, who every single gift that he gave to his fiance included a Tottenham ticket somehow. It always revolved around Tottenham. And if that's the case, of course, you know, it can be sometimes be a little bit too much. But even then, you know, you have to, I don't know if you agree, Eric, but I think you have to weigh the pros and the cons.
Yes.
Because if that makes him happy, it takes a little bit of his time, but if he's happy with that, then you should maybe...
Help, you know, support the person and everything. But you know, something else that can happen is when the person, the other, the partner doesn't have a hobby. mm-hmm. and you see the other one very excited about something, you know, oh yeah, I love, oh, where are you going? Oh, I'm going to do this now, you know, spend some time like running or whatever. And you're there, oh, okay. Then, oh, I don't have a hobby. And you kind of feel a bit lost,
left
or
out.
You know, left out. Yeah. It's like, oh, I'm not fun. I don't have anything to talk about. So sometimes it's important to also help your partner find something that he may like to do mm-hmm. to help him. I don't know if that makes sense.
After 12 years of trying, I still haven't helped her find what she likes. I haven't lost hope. One day it's
going to
happen.
I like to try many things, put it that way.
It's going to happen one day. Erika, do you find, for example, just as an example with your husband's newfound passion, yeah. it could be anything else, if it ever gets a little bit too much, how do you cope with that?
I had a good advice from a friend recently. It said whenever their other half got really talked too much about one thing or mm-hmm. the other, she would bring up an unusual fact. Mm-hmm. And her go-to fact is, do you know, the human head weighs 10 pounds. So now anytime, that's now the code word. So anytime, you know, he's gone on a little too long about hops or malt or barley or whatnot, mm-hmm. I go, you know, the human head weighs 10 pounds.
So that's a key word for him to stop.
Exactly. So, and it's done in kind of a lighthearted way. So mm-hmm. I'm not saying, oh, can you please funny, stop talking? You know, it's, he just knows that he's kind of hit my tolerance
yeah.
level.
Yeah, it's like,
and
yeah.
actually what you said is very important, because it's all about the way you say things sometimes. Yeah. Because mm-hmm. if you see that he's so excited, you're not really into it that much. And if you tell him off, like in a harsh way, then of course that's going to cause an argument. But if you do it in a lighthearted way, that seems to do the trick for
yeah,
you guys.
Definitely. And it makes him laugh as well, you yeah. know, so, mm-hmm. yeah.
And does he change the channel?
He does, actually. He does. Because he was also quite into cricket, and I do the same thing with cricket now. So, you know, once you get a certain, like, a certain amount of time for him to discuss the topic, mm-hmm. then it's kind of like, oh, human head.
Yeah, yeah, the human head. I'm definitely going to use that
one. It's good, it works.
Yeah. So we can say if your partner is very much into something and you not so much, and you got to a point where you've had enough to hear him talking about that subject or that hobby, then do it in a lighthearted way. Don't cause a problem, because don't put him off or tell him off, because that's going to be, or her off. Mm-hmm. We keep saying tell him, tell her.
It goes both ways, isn't
yeah,
it?
Yeah. yeah. Actually, we went there for a wonderful afternoon to do an Arsenal tour, a tour of the Arsenal Stadium, the new Emirates Stadium. And I actually found out things about my own football club that I never knew. I say my own as if I played for them.
I'm actually, well, almost, because he even had... he had the game, you know, that game where you play as a manager. Mm-hmm. It's like you are the manager of the team. So now and again he would come, oh, you know, I bought these new players, and you know, I don't understand why this one didn't get a visa or things like this.
Yeah, it's ridiculous.
But we decided to take him on a tour.
Yeah, it's ridiculous. But actually we had a very nice afternoon, and one of the things you can do is to try to be part of your partner's
exactly.
hobby. And you had a good time as well.
I had. Oh yeah.
Have a look how it went. Hi everyone, now I'm here at the Emirates Stadium, the home of the great, the mighty Gunners.
All right, calm down.
And since we're talking about hobbies, we're talking about your partner's hobbies, not allowing you to take over the relationship, but it's important also, Helena, that people take an active interest in your couple's hobbies, right?
Yes. For example, I don't have a clue about football, but I always support his team.
And you're
look at my t-shirt. I even got myself a t-shirt to make him happy.
I'm wearing the polo. And we're having a tour here with our very nice tour guide, Peter. And it's going to be amazing. We're
just here in the director's box and the view from here, it's amazing. Beautiful.
And this is a very good idea, I mean, of places you can go. Perhaps your partner supports a team or something. Mm-hmm. Just go in and have a look and you can, visit.
You can surprise him, actually, yes. Right?
Yeah. Like, so we surprise him.
Exactly, yeah. So I hope, actually, this is part of my birthday gift. And I hope that you enjoy the tour as much as we're going to enjoy it.
Non-refundable membership fee is a very modest £30,000. £30,000 a season, for three seasons up front, so your initial outlay, a very modest £120,000.
What you can see here, this is a tunnel where all the players, the home and away players, they used to enter the glorious Emirates Stadium. And in a few seconds you're going to see just what the pitch looks like from this angle. And I'm sure that at this time their hearts pumping, the players are nervous. But if you look there right now, you can see what marvelous, amazing view you see when you come into the stadium, when the players come out onto the pitch. This is what you'll see here. And this is where the game starts, and hopefully where Arsenal wins. So it's been a dream for me to walk through this tunnel. It's a pleasure, it's a privilege for me to be here with you today. Now that was a dream come true for me. You saw me walking down the players' tunnel there. I never thought I'd see the day that I'd do that, but it happened. and that's it. We've pretty much wrapped up with the show. I wanted to thank Erika for being here. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Yeah, thank you for having me.
And you're going to keep traveling?
Definitely. Well, maybe not quite so much now, but when I can, on the weekends.
That's amazing. Holidays. Thank you. And, you know, something very important we said here today is that it's not a battle of who spends more time doing which hobby and getting the person who's with you to do it. Mm-hmm. It's actually a matter of interests, and not interest in your interest, but in taking interest in your partner's passions.
And also understanding what a hobby can do to your partner. Mm-hmm. It will help with stress, it will help with
self-esteem. Health,
self-esteem, mm-hmm. and so many other things. So I think it's always good to support. Of course, if there's a problem with the person's hobby, like an obsession or something like beyond, mm-hmm. yeah. then you can always look for help, of course. We're talking about more serious things.
Yeah.
But apart from that, just, you know, play along and enjoy.
And remember that something you can always do is to use that to your advantage. I'm sure that your partner will always appreciate the fact that even if it's not what you are passionate about, if it's not your hobby, but that you take an interest. You know, it's something that I value a lot in our relationship, and I'm sure that if you do that, even if it's not something you enjoy doing, but you take interest and you try to get involved, you'll see how much that will bring you closer together. At the end of the day, you know, it's not a competition. It can be, if you want a healthy one, like Erika said, but it's something that can definitely bring a couple together. Okay? We hope that this program has helped you, and we'll be back again with you next week. Until then, have a wonderful night.